Hi, my name's Tiffany and I am a GMAT instructor with Manhattan Prep. Today I'll be walking you through an intermediate level data sufficiency problem. Please take 2 minutes and solve this problem on your own before we solve it together. All right, so the first thing I always look at is the information that is given to me. Here we are given that if X and Y are positive integers, this is the first thing that I'm going to write on my paper. This is a gift that the test makers are giving you. This seriously limits the number of cases that you need to consider because they're telling you that it's not negative and that it's not any other number aside from an integer, which there are a lot of those, right? Then we get into the question itself. What is the remainder when 5 to the x is divided by y? This is a little bit hard for me, at least, to conceptualize without writing something down. So I'm definitely going to write something and better understand what they're asking. All right, so I know that I have 5 to the x divided by y. What is the remainder? So when you divide something like this, 5 to the x, you're going to have your quotient and then potentially some remainder left over. And this is what we really care about. And I drove my question mark as a stick. Let's draw it as a question mark. All right, this is the portion that I really care about. At this point, we don't have a lot of additional information here. So we can move on to the statements. Sometimes you'll see other questions that contain a lot more information in the stem itself. Now you saw this T-chart appear because this is how Manhattan Prep recommends that you organize your work specifically. This helps to avoid having sloppy work. When you have sloppy work, you may miss problems simply because your work wasn't organized. You get confused about whether something was an X or a T or a 2 or whatever it may be. All right, you also saw these answer choices appear off to the right. This is a great mnemonic if you're struggling to remember what the answer choices stand for. So we have A through E as being the correct answer choices for data sufficiency problems. A stands for 1, so statement 1 alone. B is statement 2 alone. C is T or together. D is E or either, and E is N or neither. So 1 to 10 is what you're going to want to remember as the mnemonic. Moving back over here, I see that both statements are pretty similar in terms of the information that they give me. I'm going to be a little bit cautious because of that, because I know they may be hiding some kind of a trick where one of them is sufficient, one of them maybe is not. But for now, I don't know exactly which one of them may be easier. They both look same level of difficulty, so I'll start with statement 1. This gives me that x equals 3, and I have this great little setup that I already drew here, so I can plug 3 in for x. I get some quotient that I don't really care about, and then some remainder that I really do care about. Now, I don't know what the value is for y, so ultimately what I'm going to do here is test cases and determine for different y values, do I see the same pattern or different patterns appearing for the remainder value? Because this is what I really care about. I want one specific value to actually answer the question and declare the statement sufficient. I am going to start with a relatively simple number, so I'm just going to plug in 2 for y. 5 to the third is 5 times 5 is 25, and then times 5 again, so it's 125. If you need to write that on paper, that is absolutely fine. Here, you could actually do this work, but what I'm noticing is that 2 is an even number, 125 is an odd number, so we are definitely going to have a remainder of 1. And again, the quotient, I don't really care about, so I'm not going to calculate it all the way out. All right, another value I am going to test. For the next one, I really want to be thinking about how to break this trend, right? I want to prove statement 1 insufficient. That's so much easier to do than proving a statement sufficient. So I'm trying to think about a value that might give me a different remainder than a remainder of 1, and I already have a case that is coming to mind because 125 is definitely divisible by 5 neatly. So we have whatever our quotient is, and we're going to have a remainder of 0 in this case. We have two different remainders. We have a remainder of 1, remainder of 0, which means we cannot successfully answer the question posed to us. statement one is not sufficient. In Manhattan Prep, we use this grid to keep track of answer choices for elimination purposes. Now, A and D both require statement one to be sufficient on its own, which means that I can actually eliminate both of them in one go. So now I only have three answer choices to work with. All right, statement two, again, similar to statement one, but I'm gonna be a little bit cautious. Like, I definitely still wanna be testing cases or doing something to explore this. All right, so in this case, they give us Y, 5 to the X over Y equals some quotient. Again, don't care about what the quotient is, and some remainder. This time they don't give us X, which means that what we wanna see happen is testing different values of X. So I'm gonna test 5 to the 1 first because I think that's gonna be an easy number to work with. Here the quotient is simple, it's gonna be 1, and then we have a remainder of 1 left over. Now I wanna look and see if for additional powers of 5, are we going to continue to see this pattern occurring? Let's try 5 to the 2. We wanna use numbers that are relatively simple as well. We do not wanna be getting into huge complex numbers to calculate, and the GMAT will not require you to do that either because they know that you don't have a calculator. All right, so 4 goes into 25 6 times. These are still easy to calculate, so I'll calculate them. And then we have a remainder of 1 again in this case. We already know 5 to the 3, so I'm gonna do this one as well, but I'm starting to suspect that we have this pattern appearing, that we might always see this remainder of 1 appear. All right, so 4 goes into 12 3 times, and then it goes into 5 1 time with, yeah, you guessed it, a remainder of 1. All right, so at this point, it is safe to assume sufficiency for statement 2. We're seeing the same trend appear, and we can't really continue on easily exploring powers of 5 because the numbers will just get too complex. So even if there is something way down the line that breaks this pattern, we simply can't get there. But based on the pattern that we're seeing here, I'm pretty confident that we're going to continue to see this remainder of 1 repeated successively as we go through continuous powers of 5. All right, so since statement 2 is sufficient, B is going to be our correct answer here. Take a look at your work, make sure that it's organized, make sure that you really tested cases successfully like this, or that you use some other method that you felt very confident in the answer. If you did not feel confident, then make sure that you go back through and understand what you should do to get to that point. All right, thank you for tuning in and happy studies. Subscribe for more GMAT Math Spotlight videos from Manhattan Prep, and leave us a comment telling us how you solved this problem. Happy studying.